dogs. How did we get them? How are we here now? Why are there so many dog memes? The whole doggo meme is just because they're goddamn adorable. But how we actually got dogs, that's a little bit more complicated. Because you see, before there were dogs, there were wolves. And if you ever seen a wolf, they can kill you. You see one, you die. And I mean, we all know that dogs came from wolves, right? I mean, it makes sense. They both kind of look like each other. But it starts getting a little weird once you start comparing a dire wolf, like from Game of Thrones, to a little ass chihuahua that are annoying. And by the way, I still don't have a good explanation for this little piece of shit. It's more rat than wolf, I'm sorry. If you own one, you're a terrible person. Well, to set a general timeline, it started about 30,000 years ago. You see, at that time, humans were still new in the scene. They were the new kids in the block. However, gray wolves have been around for quite some time already, and they were awesome. Sure, alone they couldn't really do much, but as a pack, they were amazing. Of course, most of you already know what a pack is. There's an alpha male and alpha female. In a pack, not all of the wolves are related, but usually it was the offspring of the alpha, mainly because the alpha female is the only one that can actually give birth in that hierarchy. And as a pack, they wouldn't be able to take them on just like that. See, these wolves, they actually had a really good plan to do what they were doing. They wouldn't just outright attack. They would actually go and pursue them until they got tired. So that's how they got these big game that you usually wouldn't be able to do. Because you don't have to be the strongest, you just have to last the round. You see, wolves are like Rocky of the animal kingdom. You didn't have to be the strongest, you didn't have to be the best, you just had to outlast them. And this is what made them such fierce predators. They were just really good at tiring out these bigger animals. And once they were finally weak and tired, all of them ganged up on it, and there you go, meal for the day. Now, if you paid attention to any of your classes about the first human, it just starts sounding pretty familiar. A group of a species living together, alpha male, alpha female, bunch of their offspring, they hunt together, tire out their prey.
I think he's talking about Chewbacca.
No, humans. See, around this time, back when humans were hunters and gatherers, they were really good at hunting things. And no, obviously, they weren't as fast as a lot of these other animals. They also weren't as strong as these animals, but they were smarter, just like the wolves. So now that you have two of the most competitive predators in the animal kingdom, something always is gonna happen. There can only be one apex predator. So who is it gonna be, the wolves or the humans? Spoiler alert, it's not a dog talking to you. Or maybe it is. You see, these two species, man and wolf, they were living side by side with each other. They were basically neighbors that would just talk a bunch of shit to each other. On one side, you had the wolves being like, "Hey man, I see you hungry over there, but you wish you had this cantaloupe over here, huh?" And of course, the humans were on the other side. "Oh yeah? But I bet you wish you knew how to use fire, bitch." And in truth, both of them were kind of jealous. You know, obviously the wolves, they were fast enough to catch these a lot quicker, a lot faster. But the humans also had fire and tools, and they were able to get more nutrition out of their prey. All right, we get it. So we have the wolves and the humans. They're talking shit to each other this entire time. So now we move on to, how do you get both of those two together if they're always kind of like competing against each other? Easy. The only way you can bring two opposing sides together is with either a common enemy or a common threat. And that's exactly what happened with these two. You know how your parents usually want you to stay safe and they'll get into harm's way just to make sure that you're okay? Well, wolves are like that too. So if another predator tries to mess with their cubs, they're gonna go and attack. If something hostile is in the distance, they're gonna let them know. And of course, when it comes to wolves, that famous is undeniable. So imagine if your neighbor sounded the alarm and said, "Hey, Rush is coming over. We gotta get the hell out of here." They are your allies. So what I like to think is that one night, a cub was getting attacked and the mother warned the other wolves and they protected against it. The pack defended the cubs. The humans saw, they realized that what was threatening that was also threatening them. They decided to help out and have a big happy family. And that'd be great, but that's not exactly what could possibly happen. Soon enough, these two species started to protect each other a little bit more. And with that, their camp started getting a little bit closer. Until eventually, the wolves started being able to smell what the humans were cooking. And that obviously brought more attention to the humans. The humans were like, hey, stay back. So they would finish cooking, they would eat all their food or whatever, and they would leave to another camp because they were hunters and gatherers. They never really stayed in one place. You know the program, bro. So humans moved to another camp. The wolves would slide into the DMs and start scavenging the leftover foods that they might have left already. And you know, that kind of kept going and going until eventually at least one wolf started approaching the humans and was just like, I understand, you can put your torch down. I'm not gonna try to bite you, I just want some food. Eventually the humans just started feeding some of the wolves and were actually able to bring the cubs home sometimes. Could you imagine being a human back then and just going home and showing up with a goddamn wolf? That's insane. What do you even say that? They're like, hey guys, I have a thing. Hey guys, I made a friend. And they're all like freaking out because it's a fucking wolf, man. That's exactly what started happening. Some of these humans started bringing in these wolves and started trying to train them because they understood, hey, these wolves are really good at stuff, like warning you if there's a predator nearby so you can start defending early. So in exchange for food, you get a really good security system. That's not bad. Of course, you still have to be careful with these wolves because they were still wolves, they're still predators. So what the humans had to do was end up killing off any of the more aggressive wolves. So slowly but surely, every time that those wolves would breathe, they would kill off the more aggressive ones and keep the more docile ones. And you know, slowly but surely, you started refining all these wolves into some more cuddlier wolves that you can actually sleep with at night. Okay, so we got the part where they're wolves, they're still wolves right now. They're still wolves, right? But I mean, giving food to something just for it to be a really good security alarm, that doesn't really sound worth it, right? Well, considering the fact that literally everything else is trying to kill you, yes it is. But if that's not enough, once they finally moved in with the tribes, they started being a little bit more helpful. They would actually be able to identify prey when they would just be walking around with the humans. And that's when the humans were like, hey, I can probably figure out how to make sure that you do this all the time. It went from a dope ass alarm system to a find my iPhone but for food. And you kind of get the gist of it. Little by little, stuff started refining down. They started realizing, hey, you're really good at hearing. Hey, you can actually smell really good. So you know, you started breeding these wolves to be able to do certain things. You would breed certain dogs for being able to run fast, others to be able to track really well with their nose, others to be really alert at making sure that your surroundings are safe, and of course the bigger ones to be good attack dogs. Okay, so we get it, you understand now. That's kind of how we get, you know, these bigger dogs, these big old dogs that can really do everything that you could ever ask them for. But how do we get to these furballs? Huh? The reason why anything weird exists now, rich white people. For some reason, all throughout time, the richest white people always do some weird stuff with their money. A couple thousand years after the first hunters and gatherers really started getting along with these wolves. So a couple of thousand years after we started calling them dogs, we step it up a notch in the 19th century. As some of you may know, 19th century was the Victorian era. And a very special part about this time is that class meant everything. I'm talking the powdered wigs, the you always have to wear Gucci, all that stuff, okay? And one of the best ways that you can really show off would be what breed you have at your house. Dude, you would start carrying around a Maltese, you would be the new king of the world, dude. Basically, the noblemen of Europe during the Victorian era would start breeding these dogs to really start making them more perfect. So if you wanted a super fluffy dog, you would start, you know, getting all the dogs that would be the most fluffy until you finally get a little Pomeranian. And if you wanted a chubby little dog, you would just try to make whatever makes a pug. In short, the main reason why most breeds are well-defined now is because of the Victorian era. Before the Victorian era, pretty much all dogs kind of looked somewhat similar. They didn't have special colors or special skills so much. So if you have a small furball like I do, you can thank the rich Europeans from the 19th century. This has been Learn Something. I hope you learned something, and I hope to see you next time. Goodbye.